This material is intended for general informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. The law varies by jurisdiction and is constantly changing. For legal advice, you should consult a lawyer that can apply the appropriate law to the facts in your case.
Aloha, I'm Coralie Chun Matayoshi, and welcome to my legal podcast, What's the Law? Each week, you will learn valuable information about various legal topics to help you get through life's ups and downs, and even when things go sideways. So stay tuned. Now with me, I have Loretta Sheehan. She's a partner with the law firm of Davis, Levin, and Livingston. She's a former prosecutor and assistant U.S. attorney with over 45 jury trials involving drugs, violence, and crimes against women and children. Her practice now focuses on personal injury and wrongful death matters, including medical malpractice and birth injuries. She formerly served on the Honolulu Police Commission and receives a Jefferson Award for her work in domestic violence. Welcome, Loretta.
Thanks, Coralie. Nice to be here.
So in our last few podcasts, we talked about various forms of sexual misconduct, from sexual harassment that gives rise to employer liability to sexual assault and rape, which is punishable as crimes. Now let's chat about civil liability for perpetrators of sexual misconduct. And can you tell me the difference between criminal and civil liability for the same bad act?
Sure, I'd love to. So there's basically two systems of justice that we've got. One is the criminal system, and one is the civil system. And the criminal system is where people are arrested, they're charged, and they face penalties that include prison, they include probation, they include restitution, they include supervised release, a whole gamut of consequences. In the civil world, there's pretty much one tool in the toolbox, and that is money. Mm-hmm. And so a perpetrator who is sued civilly for acts of sexual misconduct faces having to pay money damages to compensate for the damage, to the harm that he or she has imparted.
Mm-hmm. Are there some statute of limitations on this?
Yeah, so in the criminal world, I know that in 2014, the Hawaii State Legislature amended the statute of limitations for sex assault one and sex assault two. But some of those cases are not brought because the cases are very old. There may be faded memories, there may be destroyed evidence, or survivors may simply be reluctant to come forward and have to live through that part of their life again.
That's true.
In the civil world, what's interesting is that in 2018, our legislature recognized that there was this growing awareness of childhood sexual abuse that was being uncovered and being revealed, and that people who are now adults had actually suffered sexual assaults when they were children, but hadn't had the capacity, the wherewithal, the ability to tell anyone, and consequently were living with a great deal of trauma, unexpressed, unprocessed, unrealized trauma. Mm-hmm. So what happened was the legislature passed a law that extended the statute of limitations that would allow sex abuse victims, people who had been sexually assaulted as children, to bring lawsuits that were previously precluded by the statute of limitations. By statute of limitations, I mean there's a period of time in which you must bring a lawsuit or you lose your rights. Right. So typically in Hawaii, that is 2 years. So they waived that and they extended it. They extended the statute of limitations to April 24 of 2020. There may be another extension in the wings at the legislature, but it was that statute that allowed adult survivors of childhood sexual abuse to bring lawsuits, not only against their perpetrators or the estates of their perpetrators, because their perpetrators may have been dead by that time, but also against the institutions that harbored and possibly and had the ability to control the actions of the perpetrators. Right. So that would be specifically, for example, in the Kamehameha Schools case, that would be Dr. Brown. He was their psychiatric consultant. Kamehameha schools would send boys, require their students to go see Dr. Brown. Mm-hmm. They would drive their students to Dr. Brown. They would pick them up. And there were reports that that if the children didn't want to go to Dr. Brown, they were threatened with expulsions.
Right. So that's why there was a flurry of cases filed in civil court against Kamehameha schools and the like.
Yeah, Kamehameha schools, they're not the only ones by right. any means, by any stretch. Right. Other schools, more recently we saw by Punahou, lawsuits against Punahou, against the Catholic Church. There were communities, there were hundreds of lawsuits filed against the Catholic Church.
Yeah.
The Boy Scouts.
So let's talk about Bill Cosby and why he still faces civil suits, even though his criminal conviction was overturned.
Right. So it's important to remember in his case that his criminal conviction was overturned, not because they said it didn't happen or the Pennsylvania Supreme Court didn't say he's innocent. What they said was, you know, when the prosecutor was considering charging Mr. Cosby initially, he made the determination that he couldn't go forward. There wasn't proof beyond a reasonable doubt. He wasn't going to do it. Mm-hmm. So anybody who's facing potential criminal consequences, like a criminal trial, as we discussed earlier, he or she has a Fifth Amendment right not to say a word. And,
right.
and so with assurance that he was not going to be criminally prosecuted, mm-hmm. then Mr. Cosby faced a deposition in a civil lawsuit where he admitted to mm-hmm. certain incriminating acts. And then the prosecutor changed his mind, went back and prosecuted
right.
Mr. Cosby and used some of those statements from his deposition. And the Pennsylvania Supreme Court basically said, that's not fair, that's not right. You can't tell someone we're not gonna use this against you and then use it against them. So it was essentially a case of prosecutorial misconduct. But it, on the other hand, it doesn't mean that the survivor wasn't believed or that she did anything wrong.
Right. And because of the Pennsylvania has that statute of limitations of 12 years, Bill Cosby probably will not be prosecuted again because those other cases are way too old. So
yeah.
What's the effect of a criminal conviction on a civil case? For example, the victims of the R. Kelly case,
right.
is it easier for them to get damages because he was convicted in a criminal case?
Yeah, I mean, it's already been proven, and the doctrine, it's called estoppel, but it's already been proven. And so that part of your case is done. You don't have to prove that it happened. You just have mm-hmm. to prove damages. In a civil lawsuit, there's different formulas, but it's like kind of like a math equation.
Mm-hmm.
You have to prove negligence or an intentional bad act. Mm-hmm. And then this plus cause, it's called causation. It caused harm,
mm-hmm.
and that equals damages, which, as I said before, in the civil context is largely limited to money damages.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you've already proved that the thing happened,
mm-hmm.
then all you have to do is prove that it caused some harm, and mm-hmm. then that would equate to money damages. So it makes it a lot easier.
Right.
So in the, like, for example, in the civil case against O.J. Simpson, those civil lawyers had to prove that the murder happened.
Right, because he was acquitted.
Exactly,
Mm-hmm. Right, and the burden of proof is lower. It's just preponderance of the evidence, just more
Correct.
Likely than not, than beyond a reasonable doubt in the criminal case, right?
Correct, and there's also, in a jury case, the jurors all have to be unanimous, all 12 of them. They all have mm-hmm. to agree.
Mm-hmm.
In a civil case, at least in the state of Hawaii, and it changes from state to state, we have to have a 5/6 agreement. So you can have a jury of 12 and only 10 agree.
So can the employer turn around and sue the employee who engaged in the sexual misconduct to recover judgments that the employer might have had to pay?
Absolutely. And we're seeing that more and more, where mm-hmm. there's, it's called a cross claim, where they the institution is being sued and they say, no, wait, we gotta sue that guy. It's his fault or it's her fault. And usually there's also insurance that's involved, like maybe they can offset some of their own costs through the perpetrator's insurance policy or whatever assets the perpetrator has.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, that's they definitely can, and they do.
Mm-hmm. So what kind of damages can be awarded, and how are these damages calculated?
Sometimes there's actual physical harm, like if somebody received a sexually transmitted disease or something like that, then you'd actually have physical harm, and you could ask a jury for the cost of medical care or to whatever it took to address that that physical harm. Largely, though, it's in the area of what we call general damages, which are the damages of the heart and the spirit. And it's people who have been sexually assaulted as children. They are people who live in trauma. They are people who the body has suffered an indignity, sometimes a very violent indignity, and a very troubling indignity. And the soul has too, especially when the assault happens at an age where the child feels, I should have done something. A lot of people I've met, they drag around this ball and chain of tremendous shame, and it's undeserved. They you can't, but you don't say, oh, you shouldn't feel that way. It is how they feel. It is their experience. They have been unable to tell anybody about it. They worry about what people will think if people find out that they were sexually assaulted as children.
Embarrassing.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And so the general damages are, you know, they're hard to measure. My personal view is that they are tremendous. They are, this is your whole life. Your whole life has been colored by this, and you drag it around. You drag around the shame and the blame and just the sense that you are less than, which is awful. Then there's punitive damages, which is a whole nother area, a whole nother basket. And that's actually designed to go against the institution who demonstrates a callous disregard for the safety of their students, their scouts, their parishioners. And so if you have a case where you have clear notice and like someone tells the Monsignor, the Monsignor goes, oh, no, you know, that wouldn't happen. You have a pretty good case for punitive damages because it's a callous disregard. Let's be very clear. In the 60s and 70s, pedophilia was well known. And it's just the denial was so high. And pedophiles know how to keep their victims silent. They threaten them, they seduce them, they cajole them, they tell them no, they won't be believed. They threaten to cut them off financially. I mean, there's a whole spectrum of ways that they silence their victims. So then there's punitive damages. It's a very negotiated, very strange system right now in Hawaii, where frequently these cases go to mediation behind closed doors. Everything's kept secret. The amounts are kept secret, and that, you're not criticizing it. That can serve the best interests of the clients. Many clients want to be John Doe's. They don't want this exposed, but they do want some kind of reckoning. They do want some kind of acknowledgement that this was wrong. And so that is something that is frequently negotiated. It frequently runs into the seven figures. But it's really a case-by-case determination.
But most of them are settlements where it's not public as to the amount or the details. And then they can get a release of liability as well. That's what they do.
The settlement agreements typically say this is not an admission of liability. You know, both parties want this over. You know, there's all kind of lawyer language that gets put in there. But in a very real sense, I mean, I'm not dismissing the importance of a settlement at all. Our goal as lawyers is to help our clients acknowledge the past, find their own strength from the past, and move on in it, not to forget ever, but to proceed in a way that they are newly empowered, and most importantly, to protect other children in the future. I mean, that's the power of money damages, is that these institutions, they don't want to pay. And so that's how you get people to change their rules and to change their culture and to change the way they do business, is you sue them. I mean, unfortunately, that's just the way it works. And once they have faced a consequence, they are far more likely to implement policies that, right. that really matter, that have teeth in them, and then to act on them and not just go, oh no, Coach Brown right. wouldn't possibly do that. So
that's a wrap. We want to thank Loretta Sheehan for her time and expertise. And thank you for joining us on What's the Law. Until next time, ahui ho.
Ahui ho.